Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this morning's presentation from Danfoss Marine and Offshore. We thank you all very much for joining. And my name is John Conboy. I'm the Director of Sales for Drive Segment for Middle East and North Africa. And once again, we wish you a warm welcome from the full Danfoss team here this morning. Just some practicalities to start off with. All of you have been muted. That's just to allow the presenters some noise-free presenting. But at any point, feel free to add some questions. There is a questions tab where you can ask a question at any point. And our presenters will be, I'll be checking those questions. And every so often, after a few slides or so, the presenters will be pausing. And we'll take an opportunity to ask those questions so that we can answer your questions as soon as possible after you see that piece of information that you need further info on. The webinar will be recorded, and we will also be able to share with you the recording and the presentation afterwards. During the presentation also, we'll have some short polls that you guys will be able to give us some feedback, and we can discuss those topics. And at the end, we ask you to complete a short survey just to give us some feedback on how you felt the presentation went. So as I mentioned, my name is John Conboy, and I'll be taking a short introduction into Danfoss, who we are, what we're about. And then I will hand over to my colleague, Marty, who's sitting in Finland. And Marty is our global industry expert on marine and offshore. And he will be talking to us through the global trends happening in today's world around marine and offshore. Then we move into a poll section where we will be asking all of you to be active on that one, asking certain questions and seeing your responses. Then we'll hear from our colleague Yuko, who's also sitting in Finland, around our center of excellence, and that is how we manage all of the technical, the difficult technical elements of executing projects pre and post sale, etc. And Yuko will be joined by our colleagues Jordi and David, who are sitting in Spain. And those guys can answer any of those questions that you might have as well. And then we move back into Marty, who will give us some examples of some applications and case stories from around the world. And then finally, we will finish on a Q&A session. And as I say, feel free at any point that you can enter a question into the chat, and we'll pick that up. And of course, at the end, we can manage then any outstanding questions. And we hope to close the seminar, folks, by 12 p.m. Okay, so if we move on with the introduction to Danfoss, who we are. So we are a company of close to 28,000 employees. Last year, we had 6.3 billion euro in revenue, global sales in over 100 countries, 72 factories in more than 20 countries. And we're still a privately held family-owned company headquartered out of Nordborg in Denmark. We're operating in four main business segments, and we can see, starting from the left-hand side, you can see Danfoss Power Solutions. This is basically hydraulic equipment that for typically off-road machinery and consuming around 35% of our group sales. Then we have our Danfoss Cooling segment, which is providing components, any form of component that you would find in applications around room cooling, industrial cooling, etc. Then we have, on the extreme right, we have the Danfoss heating segment, which kind of does exactly what it says on the tin. And then we have our Danfoss drives, where we're focusing today's discussion on. And you will notice that in each of our segments, we have an ambition to either be operating as the number one market leader or the number two. And on the drive side, we are globally number two, but only one percentage point behind the leading player. So a very close battle. And of course, it's our strong ambition to be number one very soon. In drives, we have 4,500 employees, 10 factories in 7 countries, and a revenue last year of 1.5 billion euro. Next slide. Then coming, just looking at the, at a bit more local approach. So Danfoss in Turkey, Middle East and Africa. This is the region that we operate out of. So we have four regional offices in that area, in Johannesburg, Istanbul, Jeddah, and also Dubai. And we have over 1,300 customers in the region, distributor network in more than 30 countries with warehousing facilities in all of the regional headquarters. And then we have over 250 employees operating out of many countries within the region. Next slide. From a Danfoss Drives perspective, we operate in all industry segments. And of course, today's focus is around the top left-hand side in marine and offshore. But of course, we also have and supply drives and have dedicated software and drives for all industry segments, water, wastewater, HVAC, power and utility, heavy industries, oil and gas, etc., and mining and minerals and chemicals. So have the full offering for all industry segments. But as I say, today's focus will be really around the marine and offshore, and we'll hear from our experts in that industry for the next hour or so. Next slide. So as I've mentioned, we have an annual revenue of 1.5 billion euro, up to 27 million drives delivered, which is actually the highest install base for any drives manufacturer in the world. And that helps because we were the first company in the world to ever mass produce VFDs. And that started back in 1968. And of course, the Danfoss brand now is made up of two components, in the sense of, since 2014, we have the Danfoss VLT, and we also have the Vacon brand of drive. So in 2014, we came together as Danfoss and Vacon to then make the globally number two drive supplier, operating with over 1,000 partner companies globally, in having presence in over 100 countries, 50 sales and service offices, and then factories in 10 countries. That's just within the drive segment itself. Next slide. And that's all you'll hear from me. Well, actually not all, but that's all you'll hear about Danfoss, really. I will remain here just to chair the rest of the meeting and handle all of your questions and answers, etc. So now I will ask my colleague Marty, who is our global industry expert, to open the webcam and open the mic, and I will hand it over to Marty. Good morning, Marty.
Good morning, and hi, everybody. So it's Martti Alatalo here, and I will start my presentation from here. So you should be able to see now presentation.
Yes, Marty.
Good. Something happened. Okay, so today's topic is marine offshore and what is the global trend and what has happened and what is going to happen, as we have seen it from Danfoss Drives perspective. And this will be quite many mini presentations. I have topic by topic short presentations. So let's go ahead. 30 minutes, what is the marine and offshore? And then later on, 20 minutes for case stories and application. It's not exactly like this. It is a little bit mixed, but it's going to cover. And what we are covering a lot of topics. So marine is so many applications. It's so many new things happening there. So we are looking what is the product, what to how to use them, and what are the trends. So everything is connected together. So I'm covering marine from many perspectives. So today it's me here, Martti Alatalo, head of the marine in Danfoss Drives. And I have been in this job since year 2000, focusing marine. My background is technical, commercial, marketing, and management. And in this job, I'm doing this marine business capabilities. So what is marine? Marine is all type of the vessels. And all the vessels we have bow and stern. We have propeller, we have propulsion, and all kind of application. It's easy to name about 100 different application for 100 different vessels. So because the topic is so wide, I will take some samples from this. Very often we say, and you hear that electrification, what it is, we say that electrification is when you are turning system or machine either to hybrid or fully electric. So electrifying the system. here you can see videos. I don't show them, but you can find out them in YouTube. But how we are approaching marine vessels and how the vessels are linked to the shore and what is the similarity from marine to land-based, there is a lot of the same technologies, like a DC-DC converter. Here we have a short video. Diesel electric propulsion. So all the power coming from diesel to propulsion. Then we support that with batteries, then we call it hybrid. And when we take power from shore to vessel, we call it shore supply. And of course, if you have batteries, you can operate it fully electric mode. Marine is one of the key industries we are involved. Marine offshore is basically whatever is floating, all type of the vessels, lake, sea, river, ocean going, and even special vessels, working vessels and rigs. All whatever is built at the shipyard, we calculate that for marine and offshore. Today we are looking at this from different perspectives. And more it's a question about efficiency and sustainability. And we are happy to have regulation for both of those. Not only marine, it's a question about ecosystem. I will explain that later on. Who we are in marine, left down corner, it's our position. We are there between number one and between number three. So we are clearly number two in marine, in low voltage drives. And then we are globally operating. Our marine business is totally global, all the region in the world. And then on right up corner, you can see how the marine business goes. It is normal, it goes up, it comes down, again it's going up. And now it's going down because of coronavirus situation. So it's varying quite much per year by year. And but in the future, we can see steady growth for coming years. What are the applications? Applications are moving liquid and air, so ventilation and cooling. It's a mechanical movement like a rudder, thruster, wind systems and cranes and hoist, and then propulsion systems. And the fourth element is shore supply. So these are the four key elements where drives are used. So we are representing drives for all of these applications. So all this is covered. And then from vessel type and size and kind of point of view, all, as I mentioned, lake going, river going, sea going, ocean going, and it can be tugboat, it can be fishing boat, it can be cargo boat, it can be tanker boat, and then special boat like dredgers, and then oil industry related vessels. And left down corner, it is a world largest vessel where we have basically all, whatever motor is used, it's run by our drives. And then cruise shipping, which is now a little bit down, but anyhow, that kind of normal cruise ship will use from us about 450 drives in cooling and ventilations. So all the vessel types from small up to big one, wherever you are using drive in motors, generators, or grid related, we have offer for that. So all the vessels, all the size, all the types, references are there. From product point of view, we have VLT product family, air cooled up to 1.4 megawatt. And then we have another brand, Vacon, that goes up to close to 6 megawatt in air cooled and liquid cooled. And from this, we do function blocks. So what are the functionalities needed in the marine? They are normal frequency converter, and then sometimes you will need a just rectifier, and then you have inverter running the motor. So this list is now all saying what has been the trend in this business. So year by year, we are getting something new. So then it was brake shoppers, then it was active front end, microgrid, and then DC-DC converter a couple of years ago. And also a couple of years ago, we got this DC quad. So this kind of building blocks is needed to build a vessel. either AC distribution or DC distribution based. So some of them we call power conversion, if you heard word power conversion. And what is coming? Building the trend. So it used to be something and now it's going to be something. And this is what we see in the future. It's going to be plug-in LNG gas battery hybrid vessels. And here we have case which we are building just now. Plug-in LNG gas battery hybrid ferry. World most clean vessel. Then the question is, why hybrid? I will come to world hybrid very many times here. Why frequency converter? Why power conversion? These are the words the professionals are using now, hybrid, frequency converter, power conversion. And the answer is quite easy, because frequency converter and power conversion is today's technology for hybridization and hybrid propulsion. And here, a little bit opening that. On the bottom, you can see that best available technology in next 15 years. I have been a little bit interviewing and studying what is the technology for coming years. We don't see any other than power electronics. Whenever it comes electric form, you will need power electronics to control grid and motor and generators and battery interfaces. So technology is here. So, and all the several perspectives are pointing to direction hybrid solution. Technology is not any more new. It is in place, it's proven, it is used in so many vessels, and it's helping to get so much better efficiency and less emissions on board. So hybrid technology is really today's technology. Here we can see diesel engine or LNG gas engine and propeller. So it is, let me say, propulsion, diesel propulsion or gas propulsion. But the trend is going to direction. It is diesel electric propulsion. Yes, we have done this last 20 years already. But what I'm aiming to say here that it's important to know what is the duty cycle. So what is the peak power and possible negative power? What is the average power from sizing and dimensioning point of view? So if you have this kind of system, diesel electric propulsion, then everything have to be peak power based. What is the highest power? You might need that 1 minute per year, but everything have to be based on that. Then we make a game changer here. Let's add battery system in this system. And now we call it hybrid. And that will change the game so that from battery to diesel, it's total different. So battery and diesel are sharing the load. So maybe diesel is giving this average power and battery is giving peak power. So what it means that better optimization and less diesel production needed. So in many cases, you can, downsize the engine or you can read out one or two of engines you have on board. So this is giving benefits, just adding battery in the system. And now even generator can be smaller, because this sharing the load between engine and the batteries. And then you have duty cycle for the battery. And later on, I will come to this, how to make size and dimension and selection for the batteries. But please keep in your mind, what is hybrid? Hybrid is here. It is two energy sources working together to the load. And the load in this case is the propulsion. Then I will start next mini presentation. Let's focus on hybrid with electric energy storage system, meaning battery. So long time ago, it used, after steam engine, it used to be like this. Let's have a diesel propulsion. And then it was going to the direction. We have diesel propulsion plus something electrical happening on board also. And then it came very important to have different kind of generators and motors. And today, those generators and motors are connected to the system with power electronics, exactly the product which we are providing. So you have synchronous generator, asynchronous generators, permanent magnet motors, generators, induction motors, generators. It doesn't matter. All of those can be used, but it will influence the vessel design. Back to this picture, propulsion. And then it's important to know what is the peak power and important to know what is the electric drive line. So that was the next step in this trend from direct to electric. Now it's electric drive line, and it's today's technology already. And it's used very much in a vessel called diesel electric propulsion. So diesel is generating rotating generator, generating AC electric, and that is used for propulsion drive. That's the history. And then some year, let's say 10 years ago, we started to see trend, shaft generator is coming. So the main engine is equipped with shaft generator, which is supporting this AC distribution on board. And the benefit from here is that you can read out from some of the engines. So from here to here, it's optimizing operational cost, but also optimizing this investment cost, CapEx. So vessel design is getting more smart now. And then in some year, long, long time ago, I used to be in lithium ion battery business 7 years, and I did about 100 different battery systems. So let me say 10 years ago, it started in marine also. So marine vessel started to use battery banks, and the battery banks are used many different ways. They are backups, they are peak saving, they are giving primary energy. But anyhow, the battery is here connected to the system, and that is optimizing the vessel usage and efficiency and emissions. And then the next step was that, okay, let's have variable speed AC distribution. So the generators are variating the speed based on that you are running the engines with different speed. And that is causing that, okay, if you have variable speed in AC distribution, you need to create this hotel load with grid converters. That was doable, and it's today's technology already in many vessels. Then next after that, recently or long time ago, but recently is because the regulation is saying you need to have shore power connection. And the shore power connection can be parallel for shaft generator utilizing the same drives you have here, or it can be directly for this AC distribution with power electronics. But keep in your mind that shore power is now more like a mandatory. And then next step is that all AC distribution is replaced with DC distribution, or vessel will have at the same time AC and DC distribution. So the trend is going direction DC distribution very strongly into this direction. And then for the purpose, I'm using here more than 5 year old picture. So 10 years ago, we had this nice picture about the vessel where we have at the same time AC distribution, DC distribution, we have batteries, we have electrical propulsion, we have a shaft generator, and then we have multi-engines. So it was modern vessel design, which is more and more the case in all of the vessels today. And the building blocks are here. You will need power conversion, energy storage, active front-end microgrid, shaft generator, shore supply, DC bus tie breakers, and then those kind of components to build the modern vessel. So what is the DC bus tie breaker is that if you have AC distribution, you have AC bus tie breaker here between vessel port and starboard side. And if you have DC distribution, you need to have similar for the DC. And then it comes different technology. And let me a little bit point out shore supply, because it is most growing trend in the marine now. So today we are talking about this kind of topologies. We have total vessel-wide DC distribution, and generators are giving AC power, which we convert from AC to DC. And then the DC is shared all over the vessel, and batteries are connected there, propulsion are connected there. So this is what we have been last 10 years, but it is today's technology and going to be more and more the future technology. And here again, I'm pointing how to make the shore supply. Maybe the biggest trend is goodbye to emission. Efficiency, okay, it's less operation cost, but emission is how we save our life. So emission control is very important. Here we have an example about a fish farm vessel in Norway. It's lightweight, all electric vessel, no engine at all. Everything is battery based. And what they do, they will save a lot of NOx emissions yearly. That's one benefit. One other benefit is total silent and no vibration, and it's no stress in fish and so. So many benefits from all electric operation. And then one of the trends we have been living already and looking in the future is that motors are going to be permanent magnet motors, but they're also going to be permanent magnet reluctance motors. And so they are extremely small and lightweight comparing the power and torque they have. So in our offering is now this so-called Danfoss motors. And what is the speciality here is that the high efficiency area is not narrow, it is very wide. So this is giving you a lot of benefit in your propulsion or winch or whatever machine design, that efficiency area is very wide in this motor. So that's opening new trend. So then it comes that, okay, we can have whatever kind of vessels. And here we have vessel again for fish farming. And it is permanent magnet motors in propulsion. And the drives are, of course, driving those motors. So this is the direction where the vessel design is going. All electric, hybrid, and even more and more for all electric. Then example from a couple of years ago, ferry, hybrid ferry. So the ferries are optimized for shore-to-shore operation, and they might be optimized for all electric or hybrid operation or peak saving. And that was saving 20 tons diesel fuel every year. So that was already good reason. Then we have a case here in Amsterdam. So you can see from this side to other side, it's only 5 minutes. This vessel is optimized for total safety, and it's optimized for peak saving. So the battery is helping only in acceleration and deceleration of the vessel. But it was huge benefit from that. And in this case, this is public case. We have case stories about it also. So you are free to investigate this case story later on. But the key thing is that vessel is built based on DC distribution. And then we have special equipment here in the middle of vessel. We call it DC quart. And it is DC selectivity equipment. So that DC you have how to control fuse burning. And if you have something, how to separate broken side from still healthy side of the vessel. And I will come back to that later on this next presentations. Here we have an example from 10 years ago. And this company in the UK was aiming to have 20% saving in the fuel. Eventually, they got 38%. So they doubled the saving calculated by fuel consumption. This is now traditional vessel, but with lithium-ion batteries, it's hybrid vessel. So they operate in hybrid mode and little bit all-electric mode. But anyhow, it's going about half an hour trip from harbor to harbor and saving so much energy. And the emissions are much less. CO emissions are 38% less than they used to be. So extremely important. And this video is exactly from that vessel, diesel electric propulsion, hybrid propulsion, shore supply, and all electric operation. Then the trend continues. In country like Norway, also many other countries, they have regulation all the road network vessels have to be all electric or hybrid, no diesel at all. So our team, Joko Liljeström, who will have a presentation after me, he has been in key role to make this kind of vessel. So we have been delivering 5 vessels for the Norway, and those are LNG gas battery hybrid vessels. And from that, the trend is continuing. So not only ferries, but now we are making bigger Ro-Pax ferries. So this is the world's most clean LNG plug-in LNG gas battery hybrid ferry. And here we have 2x6 MW power generation. Here we have 2x6 MW main propulsion. Here we have 2x1.5 MW bow thrusters. And we have 4x1.5 MW battery interfaces. So this vessel can operate 20 minutes totally based on battery power when it comes to harbor and leaves the harbor. So trend is going forward. And how it's going to forward is that still those big vessels are more traditional, but they are looking already how to make cruise ship, full-size cruise ship hybrid. But all the rest, most of the vessels today are somehow hybrid option or upgraded to hybrid, or they are new built hybrid vessels. We can see 1 MWh, we can see 2 MWh, up to 6 MWh, up to 10 MWh batteries. So the battery technology is on board and the vessels are hybrid or getting more electric operation. This is huge and big trend. So what is happening now? Everything, digitalization, electricity, fuel cells, autonomous, hybridization, LNG gas, but it means less diesel oil usage, which is good in this meaning. Then let me open one topic. Topic is that all the vessels will be in harbor in some day, and vessels are causing a lot of this NOx and particle emission in the harbor area. So this is now regulated, and at least in Europe is regulation that end of the year 2025, all harbors should provide electric power for the vessels to rid out from emissions in harbor area. So this is the trend, and it's going to be the trend in coming years. It's booming up now. Vessel comes to harbor, and the harbor is only because carrying cargo from harbor to vessel and other direction. So let's look at this from perspective less emission. So using biofuel or LNG is reducing oil usage, and then making new modern vessels is reducing usage of oil and cutting emissions even half. And then if we have local energy production for the electric, then that's no emission at all. So now the vessel and all the harbor equipment should be all electric. So this is how this kind of ecosystem is going to utilize better efficiency and causing less emission. And most important, let's say, for this topic we have today is this shore supply here. So let's focus on shore supply also later on. So thank you about this, and please give me short introduction and last topic. It will take that 3 minutes. What it means, Marty, power generation.
Yep. Sorry, Marty, we have a few questions here if we'd like please to maybe handle those. So let me see the first one here. So first is, why can't batteries alone act as the additional power source in a hybrid system? And why the need for VFDs?
Okay, batteries DC voltage. So it is normally DC voltage from 400 up to 1000 volt. So if you don't have any power conversion from that battery voltage to the propulsion or to other systems, you need to make the system based on the battery voltage. And battery voltage is variating -15 and +15% by state of the charge of the battery. So the battery voltage is not stable. It goes ups and down based on the how much you have energy in the battery and how it is charged. So then it comes to DC systems. So all the motors have to be DC. And so power electronics is adapting battery to vessel system.
Very good. And then a related question, Marty, thanks for that, is what type of batteries are used in a hybrid system?
Today, it's almost all, 95% they are lithium-ion batteries, which can be manganese-based or iron phosphate-based. But anyhow, lithium-ion batteries, that new technology we have in our mobile phones.
Very good. And then the final question for this section is, and you did mention it, it was the Danfoss DC guard. And someone has asked, you know, what is it exactly and where can it be used?
Okay, I will open that question later on in my next presentation. It's part, it is in the middle of the presentation. It is safety component.
Fantastic. Thanks, Marty.
Okay, if I make a quick trend here also, power generation hybrid propulsion in role to reduce emission. So hybridization is all over already, and it's also in the marine. So not only in marine, it's happening all over. It's mega trend. Your car, your house, your factory, transportation, everything is hybridized, all electric. And then lithium ion battery is booming up now, and the cost is coming down, and they are building gigafactories. And this is now mega trend. So this is new technology available. It came to market in about 10 years for the big sizes. Then battery availability is good enough. We are not worried about that. All batteries are available. Then all of us, we know what is IMO. It's good organization. And it is, we also have Paris Agreement, and those are linked together. And then IMO is saying some, how to say, values for example, sulfur. And then we have already from the year 2015, emission control areas. And this is now linked to the trend. So here you can see that this kind of regulations are saying that, okay, we are forced to use new technology. And then it comes to clean fuel, gas, hybrid, electric fuels, electric and fuel cells. So the new technology have to be utilized to meet the regulations. Then we came to the trends. And why hybrid? Because this is the technology today. And then you remember all the functionalities. This is the answer how to make it in practice on vessel level. And here we have this modern DC distribution technology. I will come back to this later on next presentation. And here we have the topic battery. I will open that battery topic in the next presentation. It's a question about, are we optimizing vessel for hybrid direction and getting benefit from that? Or are we optimizing the vessel for all electric direction and getting benefit from that? So now we can balance hybrid or all electric. And then it comes to propulsion where you have the batteries. Now it is hybrid propulsion. In some day, whatever is floating there are operating more and more electric mode. So thank you.
That's great. Thanks very much, Marty. So that's the first part of Marty's presentation. So now we have the polls. So time for the audience to get involved. And let's ask some questions. So the first poll here, what are the most critical criteria for you when choosing a VFD vendor? And you can see the four options below. Okay, so we have 61%, 71% have voted, 75, I think, Masha, we can close the poll at that. Okay, we got up to 80%. And here are the results. So quite a nice balance across the full questions. So marine expertise at 50%, reliability, of course, coming at number one, which is no surprise there. Local technical support been very important. And of course, then the product serviceability. So thank you very much for that one. Great, so have we another poll question? Great, so what is the most important specification when selecting VFDs? And this time you can just select one of the below. So harmonic mitigation, overall footprint, heat loss management, or the application software. So I can see that we have 30% respondents. Okay. Yep, we have over 70 now. Let's get to 75 and we can close it. Okay, fantastic. We're at 75, Mashad. We can close this one. Quite even, an even spread again, but across the top three. So very interesting that harmonic mitigation is important, overall footprint, the most important factor when you select a VFD, which is very interesting, of course. And then, of course, heat loss is coming in joint with the harmonic mitigation, and then finally, the application software. Excellent. Okay. Do we have one more question? We have indeed. So, what are the key drivers in marine industry for the MENA region now? Electric propulsion, fuel reduction, air pollution, or is it CO2, NO2 emissions? We have voting has started. And yep, we're getting up to that 70%. Just while we're waiting for that one to close, Marty, maybe you can give us a bit of information when you're next talking around the footprint, as that seemed to be very important to the people from the last question. And we have over 80% now of the people have voted, so we can close that survey. Thanks very much, Mashad. And we can see some very interesting responses here. Air pollution not being a big issue in the MENA region, certainly not as big an issue as in other parts of the world. And I just need to hide this so I can see, and we can see obviously electric propulsion is the leading question there, followed by the CO2 emissions, and then finally fuel reduction. Fantastic. Thank you everybody for those answers. Another question. This is just an interesting one. We just want to see where you think Danfoss drives are manufactured. Mainly in Denmark, USA, Finland, or Italy. So I can see we have over 50% climbing rapidly. Okay, we've gone over the 80%, so we can close this one. And the results are that 70% of you say that we manufacture in Finland, and then 30% saying in Denmark. It's kind of a little bit of a trick question, folks. Danfoss Vacon drives are manufactured in all of those countries, so just so that you're aware. And we have other manufacturing countries also, but yeah, so we were manufacturing across seven different countries. And yeah, a little bit of a trick question thrown in there. But good to see that Finland is coming out on top. I'm sure Jukko and Marty will be very happy with that one. Okay, and I think this is the final poll, and it is, what is the most common technology used for marine applications? Do you see them as active front end, common DC bus, liquid cool drives, or MV? And voting has started. Everybody's very quick off the mark there. We're up at 60%. Just a few more votes and we'll get over that 75% mark. Very good, excellent. We can close this one, Mashad. We're up at 86% of the people have voted. And the leading technology here being liquid cooled, less of you, none of you seeing MV, which is also very interesting. And then we have the tied third and or second and third would be the common DC bus and the active front end. Fantastic. Thank you all very much for your participation in the polls. I think, as I say, we have Yuko now is going to talk to us about the Center of Excellence. But I think, Marty, just a note, we have two topics there that maybe you can elaborate on around the footprint and also on the O2 CO2 emissions and the NOx emissions. If we can elaborate on those two points a little bit later, they're obviously very important to the audience that we have. So without further ado, I hand over now to Yuko. And also, I believe Jordi and David will be contributing as well. And this is talking about our center of excellence and how we manage all of those difficult technical queries that happen when we execute projects in marine. Over to you, Yuko.
Thank you, John. To start with that, you can hear me. So my voice is coming clear, loud and clear.
We can hear and see you loud
all
and
right.
clear.
Thank you very much. So can I get my slide up to start with?
Yes, indeed.
At the moment, I'm still seeing the quick poll.
Yep, it should be on the way there. There we go.
Okay, so my name is Jouko Liljeström, and in my current role in Danfoss Drives, I'm heading this Center of Excellence, and this is a team supporting projects in Danfoss Drives, and our, let's say, mission is always to help our customers to find the best fit out of our offering of products, and of course then helping building up the solution. And in this project support, the most important is that we have a close collaboration with the customer, and we can then in the pre-design phase, we can already help. And with the experience we have, we can help the customer to find out the right solution. And then, of course, it is also important that in specific topics like drive sizing, as Martti also pointed out, we can help, and we can help with what kind of enclosure solution customer that you want to have in order to let's say integrate the drive in the best possible way, and also considering the footprint of the installation. Harmonics, DC selectivity studies, those are the areas where we are also helping. So in this picture where we actually operate today is that we have today full scale of products. So we have let's say from the hardware point of view, we are utilizing same hardware, and then we have software for these different applications. So we can work with grid converter, DC-DC converter, having this protective device DC card and inverters when we run the motors. So all of these are based on same hardware. And we have dedicated application software. We also have wide range of certified grid codes. And this is of course mainly when we are talking land-based and power generation to the grid. We are having safety certifications. And of course, with this current tools, with digitalization, we can also simulate, we can make simulation models, dimensioning and selectivity studies for your system. So, and all in all, we have documentation available for you also to support this pre-design work. Next, please. And it's of course one of the strengths of Danfoss Drives is that we are present locally. So there is over 100 countries we have sales and service people, and that can support you locally. And this is of course also important in the marine environment where where the vessels are operating from different in different areas and different let's say continents. So we are able to support locally, and also we are able to use our global network for the purpose of our marine customers. And our specialists are then supporting our local teams to any of these topics that are related to, for example, when there's service needs or when there is a troubleshooting need. Next, please. So this is just to show that there are a global operational model where we have experts in all the regions to support our local organization. And this is always important when we are talking about this very different kind of, let's say, areas where you are operating, and also when there is a need for a quick access or quick, let's say, establishment of support to our customers, and then this will help to bring up the expertise also close to the customer or close to the area where you are operating. And also I would like to say that we have a team here, and in our Spanish base close to Barcelona, we have three persons working every day to help our customers, and we are utilizing our let's say expertise, and we also have a setup to make smaller scale testings, and also we can utilize this for training and also doing some functional let's say work with your let's say specific project. So I invite here Jordi and David from our Spanish side, and Jordi can explain a little bit more in detail what are our capabilities, what we can do in our, let's say, facilities in Spain. Thank you. We cannot hear you, Jordi.
Sorry, no, thanks, Yoko. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, now we can hear you.
Very good. So if we can go to the next slide, maybe. Okay, very good. So first of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Jordi Rovira. I work as a solution manager in Center of Excellence, and we have a small office located in the Barcelona area in Spain. So in this small office also, we are constantly investing for testing and running the trending applications that Danfoss develops, especially what we are focusing in hybrid applications and motor control. As you can see, for example, in this picture, this is our test lab. In the middle of the picture, we have the core of the test lab, that it's a small test bench based on 6 power modules. This is frame 4. Size units 5.5 kilowatts, it's vacuum product, and has the particularity to be able to connect in the topology that we require. This test bench is also equipped with several filters, as for example LC filters, sinus filters, DUDT filters. So the idea is, as said, to reproduce any topology, as for example a complex DC common bus solution with a operating with several applications as AFE, grid converters, DC-DC converters, we can control generators and motors, for example. Also, we are complemented with other stuff, as for example, transformers with several relation ratio in order to fit to the right voltage that we are requiring to test. Battery bank, that we can set this battery bank from 100 volts to 720 volts in steps of 100 volts. That can be connected directly to the common DC bus or through the DC-DC converter. And also we have other stuff, as for example, other grid converter with bigger power, for example, for emulating other grids, high voltage right through, for example, for the grid codes, and DC-DC power supplies for emulating PV panels, and other stuff among, for example, electrical motors. So for us, the idea is to reproduce always the same topology and functionalities that customer requires for the current projects. We also, it's a good point also to open the possibility because we have done in constant times to invite customers for learning and reproduce the same projects that they are working in real life, and for example, starting to do some pre-commissioning for real projects. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Jordi. And as said, we are here to answer any of your questions, anything you have from the pre-design or from the system configurational point of view. Any specific topics we want to discuss, we can open the questions. So I would like to thank you for listening to us, and we are here to answer any questions you have.
Fantastic, guys. Thanks very much. So I think the key message is that you're very well covered when selecting Danfoss from the technical perspective, not just locally in the MENA region, but then provided support from the Global Center of Excellence team. So thanks very much, guys. We have no question at this point in the question box, but we'll hopefully get some more questions towards the end of the discussion. So thanks again, Yuko and Jordi.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, handing back over to Marty.
Okay, thank you very much. I will take over from my computer now. And now you should see another starting page saying Danfoss Drives in Marine Offshore application and case stories. And here, it's a question about, let's start it from this very important trend, shore to vessel supply, electric power from shore to vessel. And it is many roles. And most important is to reduce emission, to stop all the engine on board. And as we mentioned already, it's important to save those noxes and particles on harbor area. And harbor area is this ecosystem. And here in the middle, we have this shore supply. We can call it many different names. It can be container, but anyhow, it's some kind of system from a power conversion to vessel so that the vessel can be plugged into the shore. It's many names, and one of the latest names people are starting to use is charging. So shore power, I guess you have been using gold ironing and so on. So everything are meaning about the same. It's question about electric from shore to vessel. Is it AC or DC? It doesn't matter in this case now. It's energy from shore to vessel. And then vessel size doesn't matter. Anyhow, shore to vessel. It's question about power conversion from grid voltage and the frequency to adapt that for vessel. Vessel might be different voltage and frequency, and then you need to have isolation, galvanical isolation. So if the grid is same as the vessel, just connect them, synchronize them. But if the vessel is different than the grid, we need to have power conversion. And the power conversion is from AC to DC and from DC back to AC. And sometimes that is very much supported by lithium ion battery storage system or some other type of battery storage system. It's supported also by local energy production. So this is the trend and application. And all those blue boxes are drives which we are providing. Then what it means if your harbor want to get shore supply? Vessels are ready or they are not ready. Anyhow, vessels should have plug for shore supply, and there is standard saying that which kind of it is. And on harbor side, you have national grid, most probably very high voltage, medium voltage, and then you need to have local transformer. And after the transformer, we have this power conversion from AC voltage to DC voltage and back to the AC voltage and isolation before the reeling and plug-in to the vessel. So this is the complete system, and our focus as a Danfoss drives is to make the power conversion, meaning this LCL filter, active front end, grid converter, sinus filter. So we are providing exactly the smooth, clean electricity for the vessel in wanted voltage level. This is the shore supply. How it looks like? It looks like most often it's container. It's a drives, transformer, a protection device, cooling device, everything. Here we have an example about how you can pack in optimum as much as possible power electronics in the container. So even 5 megavolt ampere in 20, or let's say 10 feet container as a concept. And then case studies, we have install base in the world, mostly Nordic countries, more than 100 shore supply are equipped by Danfoss drives. And here we have an example, local example in your area, and maybe Kuram, you say something about this. Okay, no voice.
I think Karam actually is there as an attendee, so I'm not sure if he has access to be able to speak right now. So,
okay, here we have a local shore supply. So what it means? It means that you take power from shore, you convert that suitable water vessel, and here we have input voltage 415, input frequency 50 hertz, and providing 415 voltage for the vessel, but the frequency is different. So this will really need power conversion from AC to AC. And the power here was 1.5 megawatt. So it was not small, it was practical size, and it was built by Vacon air-cooled NXC series. The product is coming from Finland factory, and customer in this case is in a United Arab Emirates area. I don't know exactly which country it is, but there it is. So this is exactly what is happening now. This is booming as a marine application, how to provide electric energy for the vessel. Okay, then other references. So this grid, they are saving 5,000 liter fuel per day. And here we have this CPR. They say that this back payment time was only 2 months. And then another harbor is saving 1,000 liter fuel per day. So it's really meaning how much you save fuel, and exactly meaning how much you save CO2 emission and how much you're saving other emission in that harbor area. And it might be also silent operation. So shore supply is providing a lot benefit for harbors, rigs, and vessels. What about if you are living in the city and in one night this kind of vessel comes to you? So basically you have got a thousand of people in front of you. And this kind of vessel is using about 10 megawatt power all the time. Just keep it live. Ventilation, heating, cooling, and everything is on. 10 megawatt is used energy. And what it means to get 10 megawatt? It's a lot of energy. So now it's a regulation saying that harbors should provide electric power for cruise ships, and it is a specific regulation which kind of electricity it is. Then what it means? Here we have one customer from Norway, and this customer is focusing on shore supplies, only making shore supplies, and different kind of vessels. But the most important is here, they are saying that 7% of the greenhouse gas emission from the coastal shipping occur while ship are in a port or harbor. So they are producing emission when they are in harbor. So it's now we can control that. Let's have shore supply. And then to put that in values, 10 megawatt power over the day, you will save 65,000 liter fuel. So basically, if shore is providing this 16 megavolt ampere, 16 megawatt power from shore to vessel, they can stop all the engine. So this size, full size cruise ship is saving fuel 65,000 liter per day. That's something. And the regulation is looking exactly this. Why to burn the oil if you have clean electric available? So we come back to this ecosystem. Ecosystem is very important. So shore supply is key component and it's booming up now. So thank you about this. I will move forward. hybrid propulsion, as I mentioned already in the presentation number one, is that hybrid is all over, in marine also. And then it was your question about this CO2 emission and other emissions. If vessel is going from a different kind of liquid fuel, diesel to LNG gas, here we can see on right top corner how much you are saving. So SOx are reduced almost all, 99%. NOxes are reduced 80%. And this CO2 is reduced about 25%. That is, I will open that also later on. And particles are gone almost all. And noise can be reduced about 40%. So this is the benefit using gas instead of oil. And that is also meaning a lot. And that goes to the technology. So the technology we are providing in this case, let's optimize the vessel many different way. One is how to utilize a lithium ion pad. And then it was this question, do we do it like a LNG gas vessel, which we hybridize, which is the case in many cases. So to get better performance and even better than diesel performance, let's hybridize gas vessel. And then you get benefit for operation and operational cost and efficiency. And other type was that let's build it all electric vessel from early beginning. So now we are playing with hybrid or all electric. And then we came to this, okay, let's carry on batteries on board. So battery is very, very important. Let me open topic, what is energy storage battery? So now we have a battery and load used and generator are not anymore matching together because battery is sharing the load power generation. So generators and batteries are sharing the energy for the load or power for the load. And now we are playing with the time also. We have energy in the battery, we can use it later on, not only when you are producing it. So battery is giving freedom to operate vessel. So it doesn't matter what is the system. Anyhow, it's propulsion. Now we have battery here. And then we go single line drawings. You have DC distribution and somewhere you have the battery, you need to have the battery interface. So let's talk about battery interface and battery, how to make them. Most important, all of us, is to recognize what is the duty cycle, how the vessel is operating. So what is auxiliary power, what is propulsion power, and what is all together. So how many megawatts and how many hours and how what is the shape of the duty cycle. So without duty cycle, it's no way to make any, how to say, size in the dimension and selection of the system and the battery source. So the battery guys is asking this always. So let's have a 1 megawatt. And then we put here this duty cycle. And then we start to play where we will need 1 megawatt. It's needed for auxiliary power at harbor and during whenever the vessel is visiting in harbor. And somewhere here we can find out where is 1 megawatt, what it is meaning 1 megawatt in the duty cycle. And 1 megawatt hour is 1 megawatt during 1 hour. So it is energy. And now we can play where 1 megawatt hour energy is needed to replace the fuel consumption with battery energy. And then we start play leveling where and how much is needed energy to make this vessel better by efficiency, operation, silence mode, fully electric mode, whatever. So of course we do that in Excel or Simulink or MATLAB and simulation tools, but the principle is here. And then it's very important to know that energy is 1 megawatt 1 hour or 2 megawatt 1 hour or 1 megawatt 1 hour or 2 megawatt half an hour. It is 0.5 megawatt 2 hours. So it's a question about energy, and the batteries are totally different. So we need to select the right type of the battery on board. And we have many producers. Here we have one. Batteries are different kind of, they are different chemistries, they are different form. And this is a company we have been collaborating. And they are making battery cells, modules and the battery packs suitable for marine also. And the marine battery looks like this. It is rack, in this case, providing 215 kilowatt hour energy. And the weight is about 3000 kilogram. It's not a small, it's not a big one, but anyhow, it is marinized, marine approved battery. And then the terminology used in this is very important. We have battery related terminology, battery, battery energy, battery, battery management, battery healthy. Then we have a energy management system on vessel level where you have the energy. Is that in diesel, gas or battery? Then you have a power management where the power is coming from and where you use it. So you need to control how much you give power for motors, for example. And our role is to make this power electronics, power conversion for this discussion. And then it comes to this kind of design criteria. Are you making the vessel DC or AC based? I go over this very quickly. So you recognize that these are how to make the design. And then, but anyhow, it comes here that we need to have a collaboration between owner, operator, engineering, shipyard, battery supplier, because we are looking this from different kind of perspectives. To make good hybrid vessel design, we'll need a duty cycle and understanding about energy and a well done single line drawing and then battery supplier. And then we iterate that about 4 times. Then we get proper size and dimension for batteries, drives, and the vessel operation. So this kind of process is important. That was about batteries and then system safety. Whenever you have battery on board, it comes to safety, different kind of safety. So safety, 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 and it comes to good engineering. If you think about 1 megawatt hour battery is 10,000 kilogram batteries on board, 1 megawatt hour. And batteries are different, and there is a lot of characteristics for the batteries. So what is the chemistry, which kind of cells, who is providing battery management, what about firefighting, and then who is doing battery management and which kind of. So it's monitoring the batteries, healthy, state of the charge, and so on and so on. And then what is the system? Do we have fuses? How to break the power flow if something happens? And what is the system voltage? How many batteries you have, how many strings there is, and then how to build the bigger battery. And by the way, where you have the battery room, is that on the deck or below the deck, on the keel, or is it a separate container? All these are very much influencing the safety. And the safety is very much controlled also by this terminology, battery safety, system safety, and then how you control energy and power, avoiding bad situation on board. One keyword, it was one question already, what is the DC quad? DC selectivity, when you have DC, it's a little bit different animal than this AC distribution. So the DC selectivity in case of the failure, how you burn the fuse and how long it will take. if the selectivity is based on the fuse as a bus die fuses here. So it will take more than 10 milliseconds. Okay, let's take this one, the modern. We might have so-called power electronics in the middle of this vessel system, and this is very fast reacting power electronics safety equipment. So here we are, let's simulate it. Now we have vessel operating, energy is going left and right and from battery to system and from generator to system. So all is running smoothly. Then suddenly we have a problem somewhere. And that shortcut is sucking all the current from all the vessel. And what will happen? What is not allowed to happen? It's not allowed to happen, how to say, major failure so that whole vessel is blackout. So something have to be in DC selectivity. So this equipment in the middle is reacting in 100 microseconds, even much faster. And after that, it is cutting the right side of the vessel from left side of the vessel, meaning that vessel is continuing operation without any harm about the other side of the vessel. So this DC quart is extremely high quality performance safety equipment in the middle of the vessel. And it is needed in vessels where you have to have total security for the operation, DP classes, if somebody is diving sea bottom and vessel have to stay in the place, whatever is happening other side of the vessel. So it is the extremely high performance safety equipment. And what we are able to do, we are able to simulate vessel. But we think so that you as a system integrator, you are specialist to do this one, but our capability is also on level simulation. And how we did this, for example, test driving, that now we have shortcut and it's cutting the other side of the vessel. It's proven it is DNV approved equipment. And then it comes to safety. Safety is so that you need to think about your system. What is the consequence if something happens? Is it small or is it going even catastrophe? And what is the probability for that accident? For example, if you have a fire in your battery in your vessel, is that going to be only small issue or big issue? So you need to make the vessel design all the arrangement by electrical system, firefighting system, everything, so that even fire in battery is small or medium size issue. So the vessel safety from arrangement and the system point of view have to be so that it's everything is below this green line. So you can say by your high ethic, the vessel design is safe. So the batteries, power electronics are a big part of that safety. And then IoT, what it ever means, remote monitoring, is also part of safety. So this vessel I was mentioned already a couple of times is new. We are building it already. And we are going to monitor all power generation and propulsion drives remotely out from vessel to our factory. So the vessel is totally real-time monitored, which is part of safety also. You can predict something, you can react before something is happening. So whatever is the application, monitor is needed. And digitalization is part of that. So vessel is whatever, you have drives, and via cloud-based system, it can be monitored on shore as part of the safety operation, but also other type of monitoring. So all the parameters on the board for each drives is possible to monitor and track possible failure or problem, or if you just want to know, for example, what is the voltage level, you can monitor it. So that was my second presentation about the application and how they are linked to the safety and how they are linked to the trends and what is needed to consider when you are making modern vessel to meet the regulation for efficiency and emissions and of course also how to say reliable operation and to get owners happy about vessels profitability. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thanks very much, Marty. And we have lots of questions here to try and get through. So we just have around 9 minutes left before we close. So let me start looking at the questions here and expanding this one. So I think we have a question for Center of Excellence. Maybe Jordi, you can take this one. Need to know if any configuration software is available for Marine.
Yes. Well, we have a wide range of applications for Marine segment. For example, from engine room, utilities or tech machine, we can control pumps, fans, winches, separators. We can control, for example, cranes, steering gears, and don't forget also all the electrification and hybridization applications that we have. Energy storage systems, power conversion between AC and DC, or electric propulsion systems, as for example.
Very good. And anything then in relation to, there's a follow-on question here in relation to the battery sizing in case of a hybrid solution, anything around configuration there?
Well, I would say that there are maybe two concepts when you are sizing the system. One, it's the energy that you need to, or you are required, and the power. So normally the energy, it's the kilowatt hour, and the peak power than you need also. So in order to that, we are dimensioning the drives. Normally we dimension the drives for the power.
Very good. Excellent. Then another question here, and I open it up to whoever wants to jump in, is related to grid converter. Is it possible to connect to grid converters in parallel with other energy sources?
Marty here. Yes, that is the intention. So, okay, question is still open. How to use it, but parallel energy sources like a fuel cell or batteries or solar. So all of them can be paralleled by these components we have. It can be either DC-DC converter or active front-end or microgrid. Depends on what is the power distribution where you are connecting to.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, guys. A couple of more questions here. And again, I'll open it up to whomever wants to answer it. How critical are ruggedized circuit boards in marine application? Anybody want to take that one?
Can repeat, how critical are?
Your ruggedized circuit boards or coated circuit boards, let's say.
That's new term for me. I'm not able to answer for that. So,
well, I can give some words about that. We, in our design for the boards, the circuit boards, that we ensure that all the components remain firmly against any vibrations that it's typical, for example, in marine segment or mobile segment. So that it's like a standard for us.
Okay, clear. And then we have a question around remote monitoring. I know that this is available from Danfoss, but how does it work on a ship?
Okay, in the ship, we have a field bus connection from all the drives to the switch, and the switch is connected to the platform operating in the cloud system. That's one way to do it. And the switch on board is communicating via mobile phone network close to the harbor, or based on the radio communication system, or based on the satellite communication system. But the communication system is normally provided by vessel itself. So the vessel is already, most of the vessels are nowadays with satellite communication, and they can provide us Ethernet connection, and then we switch our switch to Ethernet connection, and then we have connection to drives also. So it is normal technology in land-based, and now it's installed on board, and the communication via vessels communication systems.
Very good. Excellent. Let me just check the questions to see if we have any more. No, I think that's everything. Fantastic. Great stuff. Then I have one final slide just to share with you all, and that is to request that we please take a selfie of yourself. This is an example of me taking a selfie at a previous presentation from Danfoss. We'd like you to take a selfie and share it with us, and we can make a collage and then send it out to the audience also afterwards. Just because we can't connect together in a room, which we would normally do, then we connect online by sharing these photographs. So then we're 3 minutes to go, so we're ahead of the time. So I just wish to thank all of the attendees for your attention and also for your very interactive discussion and questions. And I also want to have a warm thank you to the presenters, Jordi, Marty, and Yuko. Thank you very much for all of that informative information. And that's it, guys. Thank you very much. So we can sign off.
Thank you very much, all. Bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. Bye. Bye-bye.